watching a robin circle the rowan tree.
It is dusk. White winter dusk.
You shall hear soon enough. You'll make yourself as sick as your mother. Poor lamb. Come, Miss Bonnie, and sit.
I hope the train is not delayed by the wolves.
Ticket, please. Come on, Miss, I haven't got all day.
Sorry, but my aunt packed my bag. Here it is.
You'd best wrap up. It's cold at night. And don't get too close to the window. It's a full moon, and the wolves are watching.
This won't do. Here, have a chocolate.
No, thank you. I never touch chocolate.
Come along. All girls like chocolate.
Ladies never eat in public, and they never speak to strangers.
It's only chocolate. It'll warm you up.
If you speak to me again, I'll pull the cord.
James, look out the window. There's a storm brewing. It's unfolding over the chase.
Don't fret, Miss Bonnie. Believe in the dawn, and the night will soon be over.
Blast it all, minx. That it should come to this. I'd no rather leave you than I'd let a tiger eat my own leg.
I'll be fine, Father. I'll rise, skate, and sing. I won't even notice that you're gone.
You're a devilish ray of light, Bonnie, and we'd be poorer without you. If I could bottle up your spirit and feed it to your poor mother, she'd be cured in minutes, you beautiful, rugged, full-hearted minx.
Your mother and I will be leaving tonight, Bonnie. We shall be gone for 3 months. Your mother's condition is worsening. She needs the sun and clean air.
I understand, Father. Don't worry about me. Just come home safe.
I'd fight all the demons in hell to make your mother well again. A little boat ride will be nothing. We love you like we love the birds in the sky and the fish in the lake. Just make sure you cause just enough trouble while you're gone that the servants will know where you are.
I will, Father. I'll keep them honest.
James will be here, and the other servants. You will want for nothing. And I've sent for your cousin Sylvia, who lives in London, to keep you company. She's had a terrible life, poor thing, and she'll need the company as much as you. She's a timid, fragile thing. They have no money and will not accept help. They'll not permit me to do anything for them.
when Gripe tells me of their condition, makes me as angry as a cornered bear. It is pride, little minx, pride that will do for them.
Will mother recover, father?
I hope so, Bonnie. I hope so. I don't know what we'll do without her. She'll recover, and we'll all be together again. And I'll tear the stars from the sky if she isn't.
And I'll drown them in the ocean for you, father.
I love you, little Bonnie Green.
I know.
There is one more thing. Do you remember Mr. Gripe, my lawyer? Do you remember his kindness? Well, I've arranged with him for you to have a new governess. She's a distant cousin of mine, and her name is Miss Slycarp. Bonnie, she'll take care of you and watch over you always.
Now we both feel better.
Thank you. It was most kind of you to lend me your rug.
Keith? Cheddar? Wensleydale? Port Salut? Come on. You must be hungry. I'm always hungry. I'm hungry like a dog. I'm hungry like a horse.
My Aunt Jane told me never to eat in front of strangers.
Well, that's all very well. Your Aunt Jane isn't here, is she? And she isn't the one going hungry on a train traveling all night and day without so much of a scrap of food, is she? Couldn't have let you freeze to death, could I? Would you like some chocolate now? I always put a bit of tiffin for a journey. Jam tarts, lemon cheesecake, Chelsea buns, cheese, a little bit of salad niçoise, maybe a beef carpaccio, or a pickled gherkin, an iced bun, or a moist muffin. Nice things, but I can never eat them all by myself. And you need something to keep you awake on a journey such as this. Can you see them?
I think so. Sometimes I think I see a tail or a blur of fur, but I can't be sure.
There are nights where the wolves are silent and only the moon howls.
It's so dark.
There's nothing as tragic as seeing a family being ripped apart by something as simple as a pack of wolves.
But the moon is so bright, floating in the sky like a... What is it? Why have we stopped? Where are we?
No need to alarm yourself. Wolves on the line, most likely.
Wolves?
We're in the heart of the woods now. But they don't often get on the train, though. 2 years ago, they did manage to climb into the guard's van and kill the driver. But they don't often eat a passenger, I assure you. It's been like this since the fools opened the Channel Tunnel. Right after the king came to the throne, they opened the tunnel, and the wolves flooded through, literally thousands of them, trying to skip the severe winters of Eastern Europe, they say. Should never open those gates, I say. He who makes himself a sheep will be eaten by the wolves.
Can't we just push through then?
Not a good idea. We'd be derailed, and there'd be no escaping then. No, we'd probably have to sit it out till daybreak. They'll keep throwing themselves against the windows. Better get used to it, miss.
What are you doing?
Keeping us safe, Sylvie, keeping us safe. They probably got the driver already. Behind me, girl, behind me!
Joy.
her train is late.
I'm aware of that fact, however it does not excuse bad manners. Where, pray, is your curtsy? Lessons in deportment, I see, shall take priority on our timetable. You there! Do not stand there smirking and dawdling, but see that my valises are taken to my apartments, my chihuahuas are fed, and my maid is immediately in attendance to help me.
Your maid, miss? Did you bring a maid with you?
No, blockhead. I shall take Lady Green's maid.
You see, that would be me, ma'am. Lady Green won't take no servants, but I do things for her.
How very interesting. You prying wretch! Who gave you permission to meddle with my private letters? How dare you!
Oh dear! I am so sorry. I didn't mean to do that. My temper is a dreadful fault, but you must not strike James like that. He is one of my best friends.
You wretched, poisonous creature! I should! Despicable! Go.
Please, miss. Girls will be girls. You must allow somewhat for high spirits and excitement, and the distress of seeing her mother.
Be quiet. Remove yourself. I am fatigued by my journey and will dine alone tonight. Serve me in my apartments on the hour. Do you comprehend?
Yes, ma'am. I am sorry, Miss Leichhardt. Ma'am, it is just, I'm worried for my cousin Sylvia. All the trains are late and the wolves are out. It is a wonder how you yourself made it here. How did you get here so early?
I just wondered is all.
A friend from Blastburn brought me.
That would be Sir Willoughby. He must be ready to leave. I'll take them to the station and see if Miss Sylvia has arrived safely. I fear the trains may be somewhat late. It is a wild nightmare.
Shapes dart in broken formation across the snow.
She heard again that lonely, heart-shaking cry of the wolves.
And the train sped on without slowing.
Through the land that never was.
unexpected.
You're alive!
It would appear so. Splendid. We better shift before they come back. Come along now, dear. You don't want to be made into wolf porridge. Pass me those bags, will you? Excellent. Let a scratch on me. They won't be back. Cowards. Only attack at that number, 10 to 1. You shouldn't be afraid of them. Wolves have howled at the moon for centuries, yet it is still there. Pass me my gun. Perhaps you need a gun. My mother used to say that every little girl should be able to cook, play the piano, sing, and shoot. Are you going afar? Let's get acquainted. My name's Grimshaw. Josiah Grimshaw.
I am going to the home of my uncle, Sir Willoughby Green.
I've heard of him. Richest man in 5 counties, isn't he? You'll have a fine time there. Are you staying for long?
Oh, yes. I live with my Aunt Jane in London, for my dear mamma and papa are dead. But there is barely enough money for food, so I'm to live at Willoughby Chase with my cousin Bonnie for a little.
And your aunt and uncle will look after you?
Oh, not for long. My poor Aunt Sophia is very delicate, and it is necessary for my uncle to take her on a long voyage south for her health. And they will have left tonight. My poor cousin Bonnie, how she will miss them. But we will have a governess there to look after us, and a great many servants. What is it? Why have we stopped?
We've arrived. Journey's end. Good. The only thing worse than traveling are lawyers and chickens. At least you can pluck a chicken. But still, I can't get used to these blasted trains. They always stop with a jolt to confuse the wolves. You see, if a wolf notices a train slowing down, they're on alert at once. So the driver goes as fast as he can until the last moment. Time to fetch the cases.
Oh. Help! Help, please!
I greatly fear that he has been stunned by his suitcase.
Stunned by his suitcase? That is what he said! Stunned by his suitcase!
We brought him here to tend to him. Another moment and the wolves would have settled the matter. It's what the lord and lady would have done.
Very good. See, he is taken care of and attends to me presently. I have work for you.
You're really here at last.
I wonder, which of us is taller?
Oh, what delightful tank we shall have.
I can't wait to show you everything. The ponies, the hothouse flowers, my giant dollhouse. We shall have such games. It will be introduce you to my dolls presently. Don't cry. This is your home now. And what delightful things we shall do together. I'm sure I can make you happy. We will go sledging and skiing, and pick primroses in the spring, and we'll have days on the moor in the summer.
I am sorry. It has been a most terrifying journey. And Miss Slycarp is a most frightening lady.
She is, but we shall see little of her. She keeps to herself most of the time. She even eats alone. You and I shall have run of this house, and what adventures we'll dream up.
Well, Doctor, it is a most unusual case. The poor gentleman has recovered consciousness, but he's clean lost all recollection of his name, his address, and who he is. I have ordered him medicines, and he must be kept very quiet and remain in bed until his memory returns. I will return to see him in a few days.
To your rooms! It is impertinent and rude to eavesdrop!
Mr. Grimshaw, it is time to begin.
The great house of Willoughby Chase is surrounded by trees.
The forest stretches in all directions, before and behind, and to the east, banked by heather and rock rose.
It's a river which flows for 50 miles to the reach of the sea.
It winds through snow-covered slopes,
through grove and orchard, to the coal tips and mills of Glasburn and beyond,
to where the seabirds circle and flew high in the air at river mouth.
And it is on this mighty frozen river that headstrong Bonnie Green
and Timberville Sylvia,
now the firmest of friends, are skating
in the frosty sunlight at dusk.
Dark, snow-scented air
blowing in their ears,
the blades scraping and sliding
over the lines.
And from the trees that line the riverbank,
watch hundreds of hares hungry pass.
We can travel much further on skates than we could by walking. The wolves, you see, cannot catch us on the ice.
Is the river frozen all the way to the sea?
I would imagine so, all the way to the river mouth, where Mama and Papa boarded their ship. I will not cry.
It may not be for long, Bonnie.
Listen to me. How selfish I am.
I'm lucky I have my mom and papa, even after they've gone. Or you, Sylvia, have no one at all.
It is not selfish, Bonnie. You're upset, that is all. And I have my Aunt Jane in London. And now you. I don't feel alone at all, you know.
They both keep to a certain hall, a figure in emerging the distance.
Isn't that Miss Slycup over there? It is not very safe to be walking so near the park boundaries. The wolves have been known to get in. Do you think she knows, or if we should warn her?
Are you sure it is Miss Slycup?
The two girls straight their eyes to study the grey figure walking beside the distant coppice.
I think it is. Are you tired, Sylvia? Could you manage another half mile? If we continue straight down the river, it will bend and bring us closer to her.
I am not at all too tired. I could easily skate another hour, 2 hours if necessary.
They increased their speed and hastened down the frozen river.
And soon the bank hid Miss Slycup from their sight.
It is very imprudent of her. I suppose coming from London, she does not realise about the wolves.
Sylvia secretly began to be a little anxious.
They had travelled a long way. The house was way out of sight.
And when they rounded the curve of the river, they saw that Miss Slycup had cut across another ridge and was even further away than ever.
Sylvia's legs were beginning to ache, tire, and blister.
Just round this next bend, and then we must meet her, or else I don't know what we can do. We will have reached the park boundaries. Moreover, the river runs into the woods, where the ice is treacherous and full of broken branches.
As they turned the bend, they saw a figure, but not the figure that they'd expected. A tall woman, briskly walking into the wood.
It is not Miss Slycup, nor in the least like her.
It isn't she!
At the sound of her voice, the woman turned around sharply and gave them an angry look.
Then she hurried on into the woods and disappeared.
And then the girls heard the sound of horses' hoofs and the rumbling of carriage wheels.
And at this point they saw Miss Slycup, far away from them, moving in the opposite direction, walking swiftly back to the house.
How peculiar! Look!
They're in the trees!
They're coming!
Go! Faster! Faster!
Swiftly, swiftly fly the skates!
Steam of ice and glint of steel!
Chasing cars, hands and feet!
Glide on ice, heel to heel!
Sharp, sharp, loud!
Sharp teeth, bare!
Breathing hard and keen to tear.
Swiftly, swiftly, fly the skate.
Gleam of ice and glint of steel.
See that pavilion by the dark trees. Head that way.
We'll never make it, Bonnie. I'm too tired. I can hardly feel my legs.
I have a friend who lives here in the woods. In a cave. Let's hope he's got away. We have to try.
Swiftly, swiftly, fly the skate.
Gleam of ice and glint of steel.
Chasing hard, panting deep.
Glide on ice, heel to heel.
Dark, fair, bad.
Sharp teeth bare,
breathing hard and keen to tear.
Swiftly, swiftly fly the skate.
Gleam of ice and glint of steel.
Miss Bonnie, that'll buy us some breathing space, but we'll be back soon. You should go home whilst you have a chance. The wolves are gone and it's a fine, sharp night, all spiky with stars. I'll keep watch here. Can you make it out, miss?
I think so.
Simon, it's nice to meet you, miss. Any friend of Miss Bonnie's is a friend of mine. Here. Have a sip of this, Journey.
What is it, Simon?
A little medicinal pick-me-up. I make it from the heather honey in summer. And with that, they set off into the clear, sparkling light.
The new snow. Crisp carpet under their feet.
Their eyes darting left and right.
A vigilant lookout for wolves.
The journey back to the house, quiet and uninterrupted.
It is strange that we do not see men out everywhere with lanterns searching for us. The last time I was late home, Father had every man on the estate out with pitchforks and muskets.
Aye, but your father's away from home now, isn't he?
He is. I suppose that is the reason.
Why, what a curious thing. Look, in the window. That's Miss Slycup.
What is she doing?
She's searching through papers. so many papers, they're everywhere. On the floor, the tables, the chairs, everywhere.
And she's not alone. It's a man.
It's Mr. Grimshaw. I think it is. But Dr. Morne said he was not to get out of bed.
What can she be doing?
Those are your father's papers. Simon, what can they be? He's gone.
He does that. He melts away into the night like mist. Some say he's wicked, a vagabond gypsy, but I say he's the best-hearted, trustiest soul that ever was. I won't hear a word said against that boy.
Will he be all right? Won't the wolves get him on the way home?
I don't believe the wolves could ever catch him. He can run so fast. Besides, he has his slingshot and can climb trees and swim from branch to branch. Nothing ever hurts Simon.
Does he live with his family?
He has no family, except his geese. In the town, they call him Simon the Goose Boy. One day in autumn, 4 or 5 years ago, he appeared at our door with nowhere to go. The leaves at his feet, the earth on his boots, his hair flicked with wheat. This boy with no roots, framed by the sun, through the winter trees, and a voice like the gentle evening.
I'll eat chestnuts and goose eggs and sleep on loose hay in a cave on your grounds if you permit me to stay. With this goose and this gander, I'll rear a great flock and I'll sell them in London, my hand drift out stock.
Four or five years ago, now he lives in a cave in the heart of the woods and travels to London to sell all his goods. All people marvel at his pure, simple life and ponder his freedom without any strife. He lives from the earth, moves silent and unseen, and sleeps by the moonlight on fields of green. And it all began one day in autumn, 4 or 5 years ago.
We should get inside and warm up. There'll be a fire lit in the nursery and warm bath water and lovely hot soup. I'm so glad you're here, Sylvia. I could have never managed on my own.
Next morning dawned, grey and lowering.
The snow falling fast out of the heavy sky.
The flakes hurrying down like falling feathers.
A great silence had fallen on the house.
Where once was laughter, there was now grief.
Only the sound of heavy clocks and shuffling feet.
And in the library, the sound of disappointment.
Here are your wages. Do not return. You are not needed anymore.
If I see even a glimpse of any of your faces in the kitchen, the parlor, or any of these rooms, then the strong arm of the law will force you to depart.
Ridiculous, ridiculous, servants,
idle good-for-nothings, lazy workshop miscreants.
Pack your things and be gone.
Pack your things and move on.
You are not needed anymore.
You are not wanted here anymore.
Ridiculous! You! What are you doing?
You told me to stay, Mom. You said you had work for me.
I did! But are you to be trusted, I wonder?
I would no rather trust him than I would trust a Frenchman or a Mexican. Or a Spaniard with a mustache.
Are you to be trusted?
I am, ma'am.
Very good. Your first job is to crate up and pack away all of the toys. It is quite ridiculous to keep this amount of gaudy rubbish for the amusement of two children.
You see, but ma'am.
At dinner time, bring them plain bread and water. That is what they are to be eating from now on when we are kind enough to permit them food. They are to have no cheese. Be gone. Be gone! Where have you two been?
I am sorry we are late for our lessons, miss. Our breakfast did not arrive. We are most hungry.
You should attend to your own breakfast from now on. Now,
what are you wearing?
Are you speaking to me?
Why are you wearing my mother's necklace?
Do not speak to me in that way, miss. You have been spoiled all your life. We shall soon see who the mistress is around here now. Go to your place and sit down. Do not speak until you are spoken to.
Who said you could wear my mother's best necklace?
Everything in this house was left entirely to my personal disposition.
But not her jewelry, not to wear. How dare you? Take it off at once. It's no better than stealing.
Another word from you and it is a dark cupboard and no food.
I don't care what you say. Take off my mother's necklace.
You insolent, ungovernable child! You shall suffer for this! And you! Our snivelling, whining waste of space. Take the doll, Mr. Grimshaw.
Please, Mr. Grimshaw!
James! James! As I've done you the favour of keeping you up when the other servants have been dismissed, you shall have to work like never before. And some of the jobs may be a little unpleasant.
Unpleasant? Like eating slugs, or cleaning the toilet, or putting your hand in a...
The children must be disciplined. Miss Green is locked up in that cupboard over there and must not be released under any circumstances. Here is the key. She has an ill-conditioned terror. Oh, she may be released at 8:30 this evening. Oh, and here's the whining one, stupid doll. Throw it in the fire.
Barbecue it. I love the smell of burning toys in the morning.
From now on, the children are to clean their own rooms, make their own beds, and wash their own plates and clothes.
Yes, ma'am.
After dinner, see to the grooming of all of the horses and ponies. They're to be sent away to be sold, save for the carriage horses.
The children's ponies as well, ma'am.
Certainly. I shall find more suitable occupation than such idle and extravagant pursuits. Now, I'm going to be busy in the estate room. You may bring me a light luncheon at 1:00. Chicken, trifle, oysters, and champagne.
You looking at me?
Take Annabelle back and don't let Mrs. Lycarp see her.
You're not going to burn her?
Of course not. You look after Annabelle. Bonnie. Why, she's gone, Miss.
Gone?
Well, it's empty.
Empty? What are you looking for?
For Bonnie. She was watching there, and now she's gone.
Will you miss her?
Dreadfully.
I'm here! James, I'm disappointed in you. You know this house is full of secret passageways, and I found one in there. I found this way out, but the tunnel goes on for much further. It would be useful to know where it goes. I was no more stuck in there than you are now. It is good she does not know about the secret passageways, though. She really has got it in for us.
She's wicked. She's a fiend.
I won't let her do that to me again.
You're right, miss. She's a thorough wrong'un. How your pa came to be so deceived by her, I'll never know.
Oh, James, he'd never met her. It was all arranged by his lawyer, Mr. Gripe. She is a relative, after all.
Even so, it's a puzzle to me that he didn't rumble her when he met her. She has a face like a dried prune. Still, he was worried over her ladyship, I suppose.
But James, why is it that she's dismissing all the servants? And why she kept you on?
Why, miss, I suppose she means to make hay while the sun is shining. Save the servants' wages and pop as much as of your pa's money into her own pocket as she can while he's away. And before he gets back, I suppose she'll be off. She kept me on to look after her and that ape Grimshaw. I made myself look all evil, sullen, and handdog while she was choosing. And I guess the trick worked. Couldn't bear to think of you girls in this house, alone, with that harpy and that gorilla. Anyway, miss, I should pack up your toys or she'll grow suspicious.
Oh, James, you can't!
He's right, Bonnie, she'll check.
But you must let me keep my little writing table, for I mean to write to Papa this very day and tell him how wicked Miss Lycup is. Then soon he'll come home.
It's no use writing to him, Miss Bonnie. He's at sea now. And his ship won't reach port for 3 months. And it'll take 3 months for him to get back. Better write to Mr. Gripe.
But I don't know how to contact Mr. Gripe. What shall I do?
James, come here at once. I need your help to move the heavy deed box.
I must go, miss. Do not let yourself be seen. You will not starve while I'm here to look after you.
Well, I'm not sitting here waiting. Shall we explore the secret passageways and see where they lead?
Is it safe, do you think?
Sylvia, you are the cleverest creature in the whole world. Together, we can bear anything that we find. The passageway must come out somewhere. And if we were shut up in it, it would be no worse than being stuck out here with Miss Slyhart.
We should take a lighted candle. If the air is foul, it will put the flame out and we would have warning. Besides, it may be dark.
It will certainly be dark. Close the door behind us, Sylvia. We do not want Miss Lycart discovering our secrets.
Passageways.
Lit by candle flames.
Narrow walls and spider webs.
Dust and creaking floor.
Shifting dark, twisting dark.
The girls tread carefully.
Each step echoes empty.
In the dead of dark gloom.
Bonnie, look! A hole in the wall, daylight!
You're right, Sylvia. Let's look. Why? That's the library.
There's Miss Lycart, and Grimshaw too.
Poke up the fire, Josiah. This must be burnt at
once now that we have succeeded in finding it.
It took me some time, but I found it.
What a good thing Sir Willoughby was careless enough to leave his will at home instead of leaving it with that old fool Gripe.
Indeed, yes.
And is it how you thought? Does he leave everything to the child?
Almost everything. There is a legacy of £20,000 a year to his niece, a few £100 to me in gratitude for my services, trifling bequest to some servants. Mention to his sister Jane, is she likely he's come poking her nose in and being meddlesome?
Not a fear of it. I made inquiries about her when I was in London. She's extremely elderly and unworldly. Moreover, she's frail and unlikely to last long. She'll never interfere. She's as old as time and as naive as love. She's as timid as a Belgian.
Excellent. I will burn this will then, there. And you must set to work at once to forge another, leaving everything to me. Have you practiced the signature?
I could do it with my left hand. I could do it blindfolded. I could do it underwater. I could...
The more confusion his affairs are found to be in, the better. It will give us more time to make our plans.
And are you certain that the event will take place? What if he should return?
My dear Josiah, the captain whom I spoke to was very certain about the condition of the ship. There is no doubt that it shall sink. We shall not be caught.
And after we're finished, we'll live in this beautiful house like king and queen, bathing and feasting in gold. Just you.
Oh,
and
do be quiet, Mr. Grimshaw. I tire of your endless prattle.
And the little ones? The children? You'll not keep them here for long.
Not for long. They can go to Gertrude. She'll soon knock the nonsense out of them. Now, do not disturb me. I must master the details of this deed.
Oh, Bonnie, your poor mother and father. It is plain that you mean nothing but pure wickedness.
We have to tell James. We have to stop her.
We'll find a way. There has to be a way.
She's no better than the wolves.
And the snow fell.